Blackstone Publishing presents Science Fiction and the Moral Imagination, Visions, Minds, Ethics, by Russell Blackford. This book is read by John Lescault. For Peter Nichols. A note to readers. In what follows, I sometimes use the letters SF for science fiction or science fictional. This is mainly based on considerations of flow or euphony. On occasion, writing SF sounds less repetitive or awkward. If inconsistency about something like this bothers you, you have been warned. I have avoided the abbreviation sci-fi, even though this increasingly predominates, especially in mass media discourse. Many older aficionados of the science fiction genre still find something offensive about it. More important, perhaps, is my residual sense that sci-fi refers mainly to space opera, or at least to action-adventure stories with a science fictional twist of some kind. Thus, it works to refer to a movie like Rogue One, a Star Wars story, as an example of sci-fi. The same might even apply to Anne Leckie's ambitious Imperial Ratched series. But consider Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, George Orwell's 1984, or Margaret Atwood's The Handmaid's Tale. These all possess the formal characteristics that define the mode or genre of science fiction. I have no compunction, therefore, about calling them SF novels, but to my ear, there would be something very strange in referring to any of them as sci-fi. In the past, Atwood has been resistant to being considered a science fiction writer. The problem is that her work often does take the form of science fiction, even though it is not the sort of thing typically evoked when people talk about or use the expression sci-fi. It has no extraterrestrial aliens or battles in outer space, but science fiction is a far broader phenomenon than space opera. Each chapter of what follows provides a reference list of literary critical works and similar that I have cited. However, most of the creative works that I discuss are novels and movies, so I have not usually provided citation details beyond the name of the author or director and the date of first publication or cinematic release. This is usually sufficient for the reader to locate a copy. In some cases, I've thought it helpful to provide a bit more information in the text. In most cases, I provide citation information such as date of publication only the first time a work is mentioned. As an appendix, however, I have included a list of works referred to more than in passing. This could also serve as a recommended reading viewing list for somebody looking to develop an overall perspective on the science fiction genre. It is a slightly idiosyncratic list, not so much because I have odd personal tastes, as these things go, as because I'm approaching science fiction from a particular perspective. Still, it's no more idiosyncratic than other such lists. Another warning. This book contains spoilers. Lots of them. On one hand, I have not gone out of my way to reveal endings pointlessly. On the other hand, the interpretation of a novel, movie, or other work often depends on what happens at the end. In many cases, there was nothing for it but to describe endings and comment on what they imply. Finally, science fiction and the moral imagination is intended to be accessible to almost anyone who is likely to pick it up, or to find it while browsing online. I assume some prior interest in the science fiction genre and some general interest in literature, but I don't assume deep knowledge of either, nor do I use a lot of critical, philosophical, or scientific jargon. Despite its particular concern, the intersection of science fiction and moral philosophy, science fiction and the moral imagination could function reasonably as an introduction to SF for someone with only limited knowledge. But if all has gone well, it also offers enough depth to enrich the understanding even of deeply read students of the genre. That, dear readers, is for you to judge. 1. Introduction. Science and the Rise of Science Fiction. Change and the Future. The future is another country. Human societies have always experienced change, whether from invasions and warfare, from mass religious movements, or from plague, famine, and natural disasters. But the revolutions in science and technology during the 17th, 18th, and 19th centuries brought something unprecedented. They greatly altered humanity's knowledge base, and with it they transformed previous understandings of humanity's place within the natural world. They changed the existing methods of industry and production, the arrangements for social organization, and, perhaps less obviously, the existing moral norms and varieties of cultural expression. As the Industrial Revolution unfolded, at first in Great Britain, but then in other European societies and their colonies, Western civilization experienced something altogether new, continual, and above all, visible change that was driven and shaped by advances in technoscience. And so, humanity discovered the future. Previously, some religious and mythological systems had described grand cycles of time, or an eventual, most likely supernatural, end of worldly things. These systems did not, however, speculate about future societies continually morphing in response to changes in the available knowledge base and technologies. As the scientist and social commentator J.D. Bernal observed much later in European modernity, human beings normally take accidental features of their own societies to be axiomatic features of the universe, likely to continue until supernaturally interrupted. Until the last few centuries, this inability to see the future, except as a continuation of the present, prevented any but mystical anticipations of it. But as Bernal elaborates, that assumption ceased to be tenable. The distinguished science fiction author, critic, and scholar James Gunn makes a similar point. Until the Industrial Revolution, to the average citizen, the future did not exist in the sense we understand the word today. As Gunn acknowledges, it was always known that there were days, years, and cycles of seasons to come, but any disruptions of these were likely to be bad news, the results of warfare, plague, and natural disasters. Humanity was less likely to look forward to a better time than to look back to an imagined paradise or golden age. Writers such as Bernal, Gunn, and the American literary theorist and critic Robert Scholes rightly emphasized the transforming role of industrialization in the 18th and 19th centuries. But let us keep in mind the reconceptualization, commencing with the 17th century scientific revolution, of humanity's imagined place in the universe. The rise, consolidation, and extension of science destroyed human exceptionalism. What then is science?
The Oxford English Dictionary defines a relevant usage of the word science that it traces to 1600.
A branch of study that deals with a connected body of demonstrated truths or with observed facts systematically classified and more or less comprehended by general laws and incorporating trustworthy methods, now especially those involving the scientific method and which incorporate falsifiable hypotheses for the discovery of new truth in its own domain. The word scientist is much more recent, dating to the 1830s and 1840s, when it was introduced as a general term, analogous to artist, to include practitioners of the specific sciences. The term was then applied retrospectively to historical individuals such as Galileo Galilei, Johannes Kepler, and Sir Isaac Newton, who saw themselves as natural philosophers, mathematicians, or students of specific areas of learning. As historians and philosophers of science are painfully aware, it is difficult to draw a line between science and pseudoscience, between the sciences and the humanities, or between scientists and others who might be either legitimate scholars or mere pseudoscientists. Worse, there is a further distinction between the natural sciences and the social sciences. Throughout this book, I primarily have in mind the natural sciences whenever I refer to science or scientists. That is, I think, the usual assumption in English.
But contrast the German term Wissenschaft, which has a far broader meaning.
It is often assumed that scientists are distinct because they employ a specific scientific method, but that is doubtful. Science often looks for causal influences that are not directly observable, so it relies heavily on hypothetico-deductive reasoning, the formulation and testing of hypotheses. However,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.